the 10-year forecast 2020. Thank you so much to Vanessa and that great panel. We have another great interactive session coming up for you here. So you're gonna really wanna be paying attention to the chat. This is actually an immersive game that we're gonna be playing that we're really excited about. We have with us today Dr. Lonny Brooks, who has been in the Institute for the Future community for a long time. Lonny is a futurist, he's an Afrofuturist. He is gonna introduce himself even more and his career of work, bringing new voices, marginalized voices into the futures conversation, helping us to bring more equity to the space. We're really grateful to have Lonny with us today. He also teaches at Cal State East Bay. He does a lot of other things, including the Afrofuturist podcast that he hosts with Ahmed Best, who he's going to introduce as well. So without any further ado, I'd love to switch it over to Lonny. Lonny, thank you so much for being with us.
Yes, thank you, Dylan. It's great. So I want to start off with taking on a journey, an Afrofuturism journey, and to play our game here with us. So you can go to our website, afrorhythms.com too, later, but we're going to use Afrorhythms in the Future as a forecasting game centering race and anti-racism and forecasting. So what does that mean? Let's go forward. So we call it Afrorhythms from the Future because we're situated in a social milieu of algorithms of oppression that get things wrong and that stereotype people. So we wanted to reshift the gaze by calling it Afrorhythms from the Future, R-I-T-H-M-S. So looking and centering and shifting the gaze of the game from a Eurocentric perspective to a Black, Indigenous, and people of color perspective. So we call it Afrorhythms for the Future. And this is, you know, a great, you know, way of shifting the gaze. I love this scene from the social protests in Oakland where we see this woman coming on a horse and kind of showing, you know, the proud stature of Black people in America. So I just love the scene. It's downtown Oakland coming down Broadway, and it just filled me with pride just to see this. You know, we were trying to create a world where Black futures matter, and that's at the heart of this game too. And so I wanted to find a few terms about that and what that means. So the rise of Afro-Blackness is a really great term from the Reverend Andrew Rollins, who talks about the rise of Afro-Blackness, a person's Black state of consciousness released from the confining and crippling slave or colonial mentality, who becomes aware of the multitude and varied possibilities and probabilities within the universe, Afro-Blackness. And it's about our vibranium as Black people, Indigenous people, people of color, where we have always been futurists. We had to be. We had to create sonic utopias and spirituals where Afrofuturism aims to reclaim and transform the trauma of past atrocities against the Black and Afro-queer diaspora. Afrofuturism combines science fiction and fantasy to reexamine how the future is currently imagined and to envision alternative futures based on the Black experience. We also, let me come back. I was queuing that up. Let's see. It's gonna come back. Oops, sorry about that. All right, we will.
As slavery forced Africans to confront an alien world by colonial technologies, Afrofuturism is born out of cruelty, and that cruelty of the white imagination. It's a complicity with the African imagination as well, was a necessary condition.
And that's all good, but I want you to hear more from these slides, and we'll get back to that at a later time. But it's a cultural worldview for interrogating Eurocentric motifs, and that's the essence of Afrofuturism. And it really gave rise to this exhibition called Unveiling Visions, The Alchemy of the Black Imagination, where the Black speculative arts movement was born out of that too. And we're talking about radical Black art as a futures window, where we see tracing the Black fantastic, the minor key sensibilities generated from the experiences of the underground by Richard Eitan. Future types that trace the circulating science fiction capital filled with promises of the future that can simultaneously constrain and unleash our imaginations. So future types, remember that term. And then Afrofuture types are Black signals of the future that find and reclaim the traces of Black cultural visions alongside erasures of those signals. So those are Afrofuture types. And that's what the game really delivers on. And I just love this art by Menzel Bozeman out of the exhibition of unveiling Black Visions and the Alchemy of the Black Imagination. Also a great poster by Stacey Robinson called When It's Wakanda, also based on a special issue that we did for the Journal of Future Studies. And we're also did curating the end of the world that's being put on right now by the Black Speculative Arts Movement through the New York Live Arts on-site line. And so I keep going unmistakably to, I want to show you everything, so we're not going to see that right now, but let's go back to where our website is, Democratizing the Future, where you can contact me at drbrooks@gmail.com. And moving forward, we've also created institutions like the Afrofuturist Podcast, where we're talking about democratizing the future. So that's where we examine, speculate, and imagine the future from a global point of view. And we're going to launch our game, this Afrofuturism journey, today, and also a beta version of it at the end of the month. So join us. And I want to preview a video about Afrorhythms Live, an immersive theater experience that's being transformed into an online setting. And so I'm going to show this video. We're going to show this video right now. It's called World Building with the Afrofuturist Podcast. So can't wait for you to see it. And here we go.
We all have agency over what the future can bring. Each of us individually can shape not only our personal future, but the future that we all live in. And the object of tonight is to get you to imagine. We want to get you to get out of the frame of reference of what you think your future might be and get as creative as possible. And we're going to see what we can build using that imagination and speculative thought. And we might come up with some cool stuff. So there are people who have tension cards. These tension cards are going to establish the parameters of our universe, and we're going to choose two cards. Let me see, raise your hand if you have a tension card. All right, all the way back there.
More or less Black feminist leadership.
More or less Black feminist leadership. Who else has a tension card?
More or less social justice.
More or less social justice. So now that we have the parameters of our universe, we have created four multiverses that we can live in, all along the spectrum of those two choices. So now you guys in your chairs, you have inspiration cards. All right, let me see. What is your inspiration card?
Oh, I have fashion.
Okay, fashion. I like this one. I like fashion. What would be an article of fashion that would give you more Black feminist leadership and more social justice? Yes?
I was just thinking about the notion of the invisibility cloak, but also like to have it be reversed. Like it can make you invisible, but it could also make you more visible, amplifying like what you normally
So an amplification cloak.
A go. Bodysuit.
A bodysuit. What does this bodysuit do?
Protects you from any kind of harm.
How about a bodysuit that repels emotional damage?
Oh.
Oh shit. Okay, here we go, y'all. Let's go. Let's go. So we have a bodysuit that when anything emotional tries to come and get you, it repels it. How could it be dystopian?
Dictators could use it.
That's what
oh. How so?
If they're not feeling emotional damage, then there's no consequence to society. So it feels like it could be a very negative thing to have a suit.
Right. So that could be dystopian. Okay. I need another inspiration, another object.
Inspiration, queer liberation.
Queer liberation. Object. Who has an object? Object, object, object. Here.
Buttons.
Buttons.
You can press a button to change your gender.
Oh. A gender shifting button. Who's with that?
Yeah.
The button should be more like you're more on a spectrum. It's more fluid.
Yeah.
It's more like post-binary.
It's not binary.
So what if the button is just like, it just regulates you through your queer liberation? It's a dial. It's not a button, it's a dial, right?
Research has shown that we can create alternative memories that heal trauma. And how do we heal the trauma of 400 years of oppression? How do we heal any personal trauma that we've had individually, collectively? And how do we create alternative memories of the future that pull us in and create resiliency for everybody? So we see this game as potentially available in schools, colleges. I played it with my students.
I like playing it with students also because, especially your students of your Afrofuturism course, they want to be creating their own cards and their own ideas that they're putting into the game. So it's not just using what we've given them, but adding to it.
Let it become a democracy of the future for everyone, available to everyone.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ahmed Best. I am the host of your Afrofuturist podcast. I'm an actor, writer, director, producer, and as Lonny stated earlier, he and I created the Afrofuturist podcast in order to have a conversation and look at things and establish equity and inclusion and in through the Afrofuturist lens. We talk to technologists, we talk to storytellers, we talk to artists, but what we really are doing is we're creating a vision of the future that is completely democratized. Afrorhythms from the Future, this game, came from that idea. How do we actively democratize the future and promote anti-racism, not just as rhetoric, but as a verb, as something you can actually do? And the way we figured that out is we play this game and we ideate and we world build using the Afrofuturist lens. And so that's what we're going to be doing right now. And thank you for being here. Thank you for bearing with us. We have our colleagues in the Afrofuturist backstage helping us facilitate the game. And so the first thing we want to do in our game is we want to define the world in which we are going to build. And that takes it, that starts in a form of what we call tensions. And the tensions, as you saw in the video, build the parameters of the world we are creating. Now, these are the tensions that we are going to be using today. And what we'd like for you to do is choose two of these cards, right? Two of these cards to create the world we are going to build. Once we have chosen those two cards, then we're going to talk about how to define those cards into the world we want to create. And then we'll put that world into our multiverse. So let's take a couple of minutes right now. And Lacey and Wayne, thank you very much for being here. Everybody watching, please put in your chat, however you want to communicate, two tensions in which you want to build a world from. We are in the Afrofuturist backstage. We're going to see which one has the most votes or which two have the most votes. And we will use those as attention. If you would like, we have a straw poll as well that we're using for helping develop the game. So the straw poll will be in the chat. So please follow the straw poll, and the straw poll will also help us vote on what we're going to be doing today. Cool. So do we have actual tensions being chosen? What do we have? What does it look like?
We've got 5 votes for more or less migration. 6 mm-hmm. votes, it looks like.
Uh-huh. 6 votes for more or less migration. What's the other? What's another tension that is being discussed?
4 votes for more or less ecotopia.
Mm-hmm. That's a really good one, especially with what's going on right now with our climate, especially on the West Coast.
More or less equality is definitely doing well with 7 votes.
More or less equality is doing well with 7 votes.
Migration has just gotten to 7-8 as well. So those are our 3 leaders right now. Police brutality is at 5 votes.
Mm. Okay, cool. Let's end the voting right now. Which has the most votes? Which two have the most votes?
Equality and migration.
Okay, so more or less equality is will be our attention one. And more or less migration will be our attention two. Okay, now that we have our attentions, we are going to define through the Afrofuturist lens what more or less equality and what more or less migration mean. Now, this is the part of the game where we get to redefine the terms of how we are going to create our world. What equality and migration might mean in Earth One, the world that we're all living in, might be something different in the world that we're creating. So when I say migration, all of you watching in the chat, what is a way we can define migration, right? And how does migration enhance our global experience? Do you have any answers in the chat? To me, migration, when I talk about migration, I think about how cultures share what is inherently valuable to themselves with other cultures. And I think migration enhances that experience, right? So, you know, take the United States, for example. I grew up in New York City, up from the South Bronx. And the thing that I loved about growing up in New York City was how multicultural it was. You know, mostly in the Bronx were people of Caribbean descent, and all of these Caribbean islands had their own specific rituals, food, things they did, celebrations. And in my building growing up, we all celebrated everybody else's holidays. We celebrated everybody else's food.
Ahmed, we have a couple comments from the chat.
Okay, great. What do we have? So
we've got moving from a place of high risk and or low opportunity to a place of higher well-being and more opportunity.
Okay, that's a good one.
Also thinking about migration, global citizenship, the ability to move or relocate across the globe without the need for visas or applications.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay.
We also have administration of open or restricting movement of people across borders, policies mm-hmm. encouraging or inviting versus prohibiting migration?
So I like this idea of migration being borderless, right? Being the fact that you can move across this globe you are a citizen of the globe. You don't need a special pass or passport or reasoning to move from one place to the other, right? So let's make migration this idea of global kind of inclusiveness, moving from a world of poorly managed emotions to a world of empathy and spaces where people listen loudly and love dialogue. I love this one that came in on the chat, to most influential form of sharing and mixing thoughts. That I think that is a great definition of migration. That is a great definition of migration. Yeah. How about when we talk about equality? How do we define equality? How are we going to define equality in this world? The ability to do what, right? The ability to share what? What does equality mean? And through an Afrofuturist lens, equality wasn't necessarily everybody got to do everything when they wanted to, right? Equality was not just physical, equality of thought, equality of experience, equality of being. You know, I talk a lot about this when we talk about queering the future. In a lot of tribal situations, a lot of tribal tribal economies and societies, the other had a place in society. It wasn't on the outside, right? So if you were queer, if you were lesbian, if you were gay, if you were trans, that had a place in society. It wasn't this outcast offshoot other idea in which you were considered weird or abnormal. It was just you were that. And that place in the and a lot of times, you know, a lot of Asian cultures, the queer individual was oftentimes worshipped. You know, they were deified. So equality, what is equality? You know, when we're talking about inclusiveness. Go ahead, Lacey.
Yeah, I've got some here. Equality, we all hold the same value as a part of the human race.
What is value?
Another one, global access. Mm-hmm. Also thinking about equality of voice. Or equality can be sameness or autonomy.
Interesting. Sameness or autonomy. Carol, who wrote that? What do you mean by sameness or autonomy? Equitable access to power, funding, and mentors. Ah, I like that as well. But yeah, I want to please. Yes.
Yeah. Maybe equality as liberation too, right?
Right. I love this one too. Equality is the freedom to be yourself and the structures that support and encourage freedom. That goes along with what you're saying. Equality is liberation. Let's go with that. Let's go with equality as liberation, right? And the ability to be liberated to be who you are in your authentic self, right? So we have migration, as we defined it, was this ability to be able to move globally, as well as global citizenship, as well as sharing culture, right? The ability to share culture and pass culture through without any devices in front of you, without any hurdles, without any barriers or obstacles to being who you are. Everyone's culture is embraced. And equality, this is the ability to be liberated, to be your authentic self without any penalization or without any recourse. So let's make those our world. So when we're talking about building a multiverse, we're talking about where in this universe, more or less migration, more or less equality, we want to put our world, right? Now, everyone's idea of utopia isn't the same. You know, so most possible migration, most possible equality might not be utopia for some people. So we have to vote on where we want to put this thing. What we want to build, right? Because one person's utopia is another person's dystopia. And we have to keep checks on one another to make sure that everyone in our world, everyone in society is getting the same amount of equity and inclusion, okay? So let's choose where we want to put our world, right? 1 in 5, 1 in 5. And in the chat, put your suggestions in the chat, right? And then we'll talk about it and then we'll vote on it. All right, what do we have in the chat? Anybody have any ideas?
Five and five
is a big one. That's always the first. It's either 5 or 3. Nobody wants to make a bold decision. So I'm gonna hold off on 5 and 5 right now. Because when we build our artifacts, you'll see why, right? You'll see why when we start building artifacts. Any more in the chat? Where should we put it? More or less migration, least possible equity, most possible equality. I'm sorry, equality. Where do you want to put it? Where do you want to put it?
Equality 5, migration 4 is coming through.
Equality 5, migration 4. Okay, let's build that world. Let's put equality 5, most possible equality, and a lot of migration, but not complete migration, not all the migration. This is going to be interesting. Okay, so now we are going to build the artifacts that are going to be populating this world. In order to build the artifact, we need these two types of cards. One is an inspiration card. The other one is an object card. Now you use the inspiration to build the object based on this world of most possible equality, a great deal of migration, right? So what do these inspiration cards say to you with the object that you pair them with? And how does that define our world that we've decided to build, right? And then at the end of this, we're going to vote on the obelisk, the artifact that is most impactful to the group, and that'll be our obelisk for the world. Okay, so do we have a poll for this? Yes, do we have a poll? Or are we gonna do this through chat? Afrofuturist backstage. So, all right, everyone in the chat, if you have an idea for an artifact using any of these 6 cards, use the inspiration card to build an artifact, feel free to put that in the chat and we will discuss it. We will talk about it.
And you know, this morning with Jay McGonigal, we had a 5 minutes into the future where we talked about surveillance shoes. So interesting that that's an object here, you know,
yeah, for absolutely.
Tracking health and movement in light of pandemics.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a really good one, especially for the climate that we're living in right now. So we have someone chose new modes of sensing plus city. So what would be an artifact that we could build with new modes of sensing plus city that'll give us the most possible equality with a great deal of migration, right? In the chat. Anybody with an idea? Most possible equality, a great deal of migration, new modes of sensing and a city. So new modes of sensing is a haptic interface, growth of transsensory knowledge and customized sensory experiences. So this is going to be a very empathic artifact, right? And it could be something that you feel, it could be something that the citizens of our world feel. Here's one. Glasses to see the world differently. Okay, glasses that see the world differently. So how would we see this world? Maybe, and this goes along with not the most possible not migration, but a great deal of migration. Right? If there is a barrier to you migrating to a certain place, you can put on these glasses and through them, you can see where each person has been and where you've intersected. And as this comment came through, I just read that, I thought that was interesting, right? These glasses can see where you've been and where you've intersected, and it can build community trust, right? Because that's what would prevent the migration. Yeah, the migration would be prevented by trust, I think. And I think that's what's going on in our globe today, right? It's prejudice, it's assumptions, and it's lack of trust, right? So the trust glasses would be a really good artifact for those, that small minority of people who are not with complete and total migration. Oh, I like this one. A neural implant that senses your needs, scans the available resources in the city around the world, and identifies the places where you might best thrive. I think that's a really good artifact. A really, really, really good artifact. A neural implant that senses your needs, scans the available resources in cities around the world, and identifies the place where you might best thrive. I think what would be fantastic with that neural implant is something personally emotional, right, that gives you that you're able to communicate with, so you can find that place of equality, right? Mm-hmm. Some place that really shows you something, that really shows you who your authentic self and how you would be best as a contributor, not just to the world but to yourself. Then you put the glasses on, or you put the neural, you have the neural implant, and that neural implant will take you to that part of the world. That'd be beautiful.
Wow.
Neighborhood obelisk. Oh yeah, go ahead. What do we have?
Yeah, we've got some more. A button that switches people's point of view to be in the other person's shoes in a different city.
That's fantastic. I love that. You know, we have a lot of empathy. When we start looking through the Afrofuturist lens, empathy is a really big thing that starts coming up. And being able to walk a mile in someone else's shoes is incredibly important. I love that artifact. What else?
A map app that vibrates when you are in a neighborhood to reflect how diverse the people in that neighborhood are, and you can decide whether to settle there.
That's interesting. It would be also enhanced if the neighborhood could decide whether you can settle there as well, you know, where you have this like symbiotic relationship, right? So you can't just plant a flag and live there. The neighborhood has to really respond to you emotionally as well.
Here's another.
I just saw this one too. A siren that sounds around the city when homogeneity of any kind, race, gender, sex, perspective, political affiliation, cuisine reaches a certain rate. Wow.
Wow. Awesome. So it's a multicultural alarm. An alarm goes off when you're not being multicultural. Huh. I can use that in my neighborhood right now.
Yes, please.
That's a great artifact. Let's keep track of all these artifacts. Afrofuturist backstage. So when we get to vote, we know what we're voting on. More stuff. See, this is when the game gets good, when people's imaginations start going and we start really figuring some interesting stuff out. Go ahead, Lacey, what else?
Jewels or apparel that transmit senses of sound or other senses, you can pass on to someone else feelings of belonging that you can share.
Wow. So this is this collective emotional jewel. What makes somebody feel good, you can share with them. Like if you really like a spot and what that spot makes you feel, if you have a favorite tree that you sit under, everyone can share in that feeling of what it feels like to sit under that favorite tree. I love that. Wow, more stuff.
This is fascinating. A new Wall Street where our authentic selves can be mutually exchanged and shared to increase the value of others and the broader society overall.
Wow, that's phenomenal. How would they be shared? See, this is the part where I really want to talk to people, because I really want to get to the idea of what is the mutual sharing, and is it a voluntary exchange? Is it a mandatory exchange? Does everyone have to be on the exchange? And the what's the payout, what's the dividend, what's the equity? I love that. That's a great one. More, please. More.
A transcranial magnetic stimulator that improves mood when immersed in diversity.
I like that. I'd be a very happy person because I am constantly in a diverse situation. That's wonderful. More artifacts.
A window or graffiti art that gives you a sense of euphoria and empathy.
See, now you're talking about my childhood. Growing up in the South Bronx, we would see those trains with graffiti all over them. And you know, every train had a tag on it. And some of those guys who used to tag those trains used to live in my neighborhood. So when we see the trains go by, we'd see their artwork and we'd all cheer for them. They got it done. Even though we weren't supposed to do it, it was a way that really built community. And you know, it built a nice little friendly sense of competition as well. But to see your artwork traveling through the city where millions of eyes are on it was just such an elevated experience, especially being from the South Bronx where we didn't have very much but our expression. So that one speaks to my soul. You hit me where I live on that one. You hit me where I live. What's another one, Leith?
We've got a shoe ritual. It's randomized whose shoes you get next. I'd like to see all the men getting heels for the next week, or the professional athletes getting not expensive, fancy athletic shoes, but old, loved, beat up ones.
What if those shoes contained the emotional reason for them being bought, right? You have these empathy-styled shoes and the emotional reason why you're giving them up, right? Why you're giving them to somebody else. So when you're walking in these people's shoes, you have a sense of why they got them, why they thought they needed them, and why they don't need them anymore. That's fantastic.
Sense 8 shoe.
Yeah, Sense 8 shoe. Absolutely. What is this Orisha one, a community pod that gives you? Do you see that one, Lacey? Can you read that one? A community pod that gives you reminds you of your Orisha wherever you are in the world. And that Orisha helps you navigate the new place you're coming to live in. A transcranial magnetic simulator that improves mood when immersed in diverse. That's we talked about that one. But I like this Orisha one because, you know, if you're familiar with the Yoruba religion or Corumble or Santeria, you realize your Orisha is the spirit that follows you through your life, that gives you guidance. So we are still human in this world, and we come with a certain amount of baggage through our experience. And it's always good to have some kind of a guidance or some kind of a guide to help you in a new place because of fear, right? We all are afraid of new things. We're all afraid to step into something new. And, you know, we do what I call precognitive prognostication, which is like, we always imagine the future to be worse than it is. And in actuality, it's really not that bad. You know, when you step into the future, it's actually okay. Your idea of the future is a lot worse than what it actually is. And that's in most situations. So I like having this guide to help you through the apprehension of moving to a new place. It could be like, instead of Siri, you can have Orisha, you know? So when you walk into a new place, you can go, hey, Oshun, what is this place and will I be happy here? You know?
Love it.
Hey, yeah, Obatala, yeah. Do I need to stay or can I get an apartment or should I invest in the neighborhood?
Yes.
We have enough time for
a couple more.
One more, yeah.
Okay. How about a neurosensor that acts as a personal guide, helping to make a self-reflection when exposed to people from different backgrounds?
Yes, I think that's fantastic. Especially when you are making snap judgments of people that you don't know. You know, a lot of times, because of our experience, again, in life, we see someone that reminds us of someone, and then all of a sudden, you know, we have this judgment about who they are. So this is kind of like an anti-prejudice neurosensor. So when you encounter someone new, right, or you encounter a group of people or a situation of people, then you start to judge the situation, the sensor will go off and be like, hey, you're judging, stop judging. This person is actually pretty cool. And then maybe if both of you have the neurosensors and you both start judging each other, it forces you to have a meal together.
Ooh, it's the full spectrum meter.
Full spectrum meter. Okay, that was wonderful. That was wonderful. That is time for us on artifacts. So now we get to vote on an obelisk. So if there's a link to all of the artifacts, we will share that link. Choose your artifact that you want to be as an obelisk, and we will put that on our game board. So go to the straw poll, make your choice, and then the winner will be our obelisk for our game. Do we have votes? What are the votes coming in? Let's do the vote night where we like have the big iPad like on CNN or something.
Yes. You
know, we get to see the percentages of votes coming in. So what does it look like right now? What do the votes look like on the straw poll? What did the straw poll votes look like? Oh, wow. Here we go. I got a big iPad. Okay.
Wow.
Okay, so 29%. Oof. Wow. This is a really good poll. This is a really good poll.
It's shifting.
The new Wall Street is getting a lot more votes now. Wait. No. The neural implant that scans your city. I like that one.
Yeah, wow.
Okay, yeah, you guys like got.
This is like election night.
This is much better than watching election results. You have a few more minutes to get in your votes. You have a few more seconds to get in the vote. So make sure everybody votes. Please put your vote in. Put your vote in for our obelisk for our world. This is exciting.
Wow.
All right, do we have a clear winner? And that's time, the voting is now closed. Who do we have emerged as our winner? Our winner is a sensor to act as a guide when meeting people from new backgrounds to reduce snap judgment and prejudice. That is our obelisk for our world. Beautiful. Wow. The inspiration for the object was new modes of sensing and city. Mm. And that's our world. So we voted for a world that has a great deal amount of migration, a great deal amount of equality, ultimate equality. And what we came up with was a way to meet people and eliminate prejudice. I think that's a beautiful, beautiful obelisk to put into our world. And that is our game for today. Thank you for playing Afrorhythms from the Future. This is what I will say. James Baldwin has a really, really good quote. And James Baldwin says, "If I am in despair, you are in danger." Mm-hmm. And what I love about what we're doing with Afrorhythms, and what I love about what we're doing with the Afrofuturist podcast, is using the gaze of Afrofuturism to actively eliminate that Eurocentric mind thinking and the white supremacy view to create a tool for inclusivity and equity. And what we're doing with this game is we are giving you a map, a way, a method to eliminate despair. And that's our goal. A lot of times when we talk about active anti-racism, we have to actively, in every situation that we are in, ask ourselves with what we are doing, are we perpetuating white supremacy? And white supremacy is exclusivity. It is the most damaging force on this planet. And using Afrorhythms and through the Afrofuturist gaze, white supremacy is obliterated by the radical imagination of togetherness. Thank you so much for playing.
Thank you.
Has online life left you feel like you're stuck in a box? Join us for a social reality experiment. in the TYF Lounge. Our Vantage partners are invited to join us in the TYF Lounge, where you'll be able to mingle with other attendees face-to-face in a 3D world, all inside a normal browser window. Hope to see you there.